Good morning. Welcome to our worship service. It is a joy to be able to be here and share with you this morning. Quick look at our announcements. For the foreseeable future, we will continue to have closed worship services. We will be pre-recording our services, and you can view them on Sunday mornings on YouTube or Facebook. You will be sent a link, and you can follow the link to get to the service. If you have a child or know of a child that would be interested in joining with our children's worship service, contact Cindy Bova. She will be happy to get you set up and have your child join that group. Church chat is scheduled for 7 p.m. on Wednesday evening. We hope everybody can join us there. Again, there should be a link for that Zoom meeting that is sent out to you. All you have to do is click on the link and join in the fellowship time. Coming up for birthdays, on July 3rd is Jennifer's birthday, and on July 5th, it's Mark's birthday. At this time, let us quiet ourselves as we prepare for worship.
Join me in the call to worship. Today is a day especially created for you to find peace and hope.
In the midst of our hectic lives, we surely need such a time as this.
Come rest in the Lord.
Our souls long for God's refreshing love.
Let the demands of your week melt away in God's presence.
Refresh and restore us, O Lord.
Our focus statement: cease your fearful fretting. God's love is lavished upon you. It is always there for you, offering healing and hope.
When I cannot stand Search me. Hi guys, how are we doing today?
Good.
Good. Are we ready for our story?
Good.
Yeah. Well, today we're going to play a game first, and it's called One of These Things is Not Like the Other. And I think you've seen it. If you've ever seen Sesame Street, they do this. So Aunt Cindy's going to, if you have your sheets, pick up your the one that has the donkey, the doggy, and the dolphin. Can you tell me which one doesn't belong? Very good, Mackenzie.
The dolphin.
The dolphin. Why doesn't the dolphin belong?
Because it doesn't have four legs like the others.
That's right. It doesn't have four legs. Does everybody agree that it's the dolphin that's different? Yeah, Matthew and Elizabeth and Gianna agree. And Brooklyn, do you agree?
Yeah.
Very good. So the next one, I'm going to pick up our next sheet. And what's in here? That is a, what are those? Anybody tell me what that is? What's this?
Ice cream.
And hamburger. You guys think,
and a hot dog.
Yeah. Dog. Which one doesn't belong?
Ice cream.
Yeah, Gianna has it. Which one doesn't belong?
Ice cream.
Yeah. You're right. Why?
Because it's a dessert, not like a dinner or a lunch thing.
Very, very cool. That's right. That's a dessert. And who likes to eat dessert before they have their hamburgers? Aunt Cindy does too. I love eating dessert first. Now our next picture is three women with babies, right? Yay, Gianna's got it. Thank you. Very good, Mackenzie. Which one is not like the others?
This one.
Or this one, or this one?
The last one.
The last one? Why do you think she's not like the others?
Because she's older.
Because she's older. So would she, you think she's that more like one. A grandma?
That one.
That's right. You're right. But you know what? This one is actually a mommy. Like you said, she's a mommy, and she's a mommy. But she's 100 years old. Do you know anybody whose mommy is 100 years old when they were a baby? Well, we're going to learn about that today in our Bibles on page 46. Are you guys ready? You're going to, Mackenzie, are you going to show pictures for us? Okay, Elizabeth, we'll try this. I'm going to hold it up as best I can. Can you read that?
Yeah.
Okay, you read, and Mackenzie's going to hold the pictures.
One hot day,
Abraham
was resting near his tent, he heard footsteps. Three men were standing nearby. Abraham went to greet them. Would you like to rest in the shade? We have plenty of cool water to drink. Can I get you something to eat?
Very good.
Abraham told
Sarah
about the visitors. He asked her to make a tasty meal. While they were eating, the three visitors shared some exciting news. They said, "Your wife is going to have a son." Sarah heard what they said. She laughed, thinking, "I am too old." God asked Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh? Anything is possible with the Lord." Sure enough, the next year, Sarah had a baby girl. They named him...
Baby boy.
They named him...
Isaac. Very, very good. So Sarah was 100 years old. Thank you so much, Mackenzie, and thank you so much, Elizabeth, for helping us do our story this morning. But Sarah was 100 years old when she had baby Isaac. And she had him because Sarah had always wanted a baby, but never got to have one. And she waited and waited and waited. And when she was 100, she didn't think she could ever have a child. But when the three visitors told her husband, Abraham, that she was going to have one, what did she do? What did Sarah do?
Laughed.
I can't have a baby. I'm 100 years old. And what did God say?
Anything is possible.
That's right. With God, all things are possible. And it's important to know that when God makes a promise, God keeps his promise. And God wants us to keep our promises too. It's important that when we promise things to one another, that we think about how God would want us to follow through on that promise. So if God keeps his promises to you, is it important for us to keep our promises to others? Yeah. And that's what our story is about today. It's about baby Isaac and his mommy and daddy, Sarah and Abraham, and that it doesn't matter what you think is impossible, because with God, all things are possible. Did you guys like that story today? You did very good on the one thing doesn't belong with the others. We're going to have to play that more next week. Does that sound like a good idea? Alrighty. So I'm going to ask you guys all to wait. Yes, Matthew.
How old is Abraham then?
Abraham was about 100, and I think he was older than Sarah. So let's say he was maybe 110. I think he was a little bit older. So that's really old too for a dad, huh? But I bet he played baseball with Isaac, and I bet he played games and taught him all kinds of different things, because that's what mommy and daddies do, right? All righty. Well, let's say goodbye to all of our friends out there that are watching today, and wish them a happy week. And I miss you guys, and I love you. And thank you so much for helping with the story, Elizabeth and Matthew. Bye. Mackenzie, bye. Gianna and Mia, bye-bye. And Brooklyn and Lily, bye-bye. We love you guys. We'll see you next week, okay?
Bye.
Say bye, everybody.
Bye.
Blow kisses.
There we go. Well, hello, church. Please join me in prayer. O servant of all whose body was destroyed by an empire for bodily protesting, economic exploitation in a place of worship, teach us to trust only in you for our deliverance. Purge from our midst all claims that we might earn through human effort the dignity and respect that only you can grant. You are our Savior, good Christ, not our actions, not our proper clothes, clean language, or respectable jobs, or good works. Only you can deliver us from bondage, and we cannot do anything to earn your love revealed fully in the body of Jesus the carpenter. Still, divine organizer, whose light and life saturates our world. Through you, our very bodies are animated and agitated for justice. Soothe us, center us, and drive us forth from comfort to do the work of your people in the world. Though we may face the tools of the devil and bear the scars of excessive force or unjust weapons, do not let us be overcome. Let us not be at peace until there is justice in our midst, that we may bear witness to the transformative power of Jesus Christ, today and always. Amen and amen. As we continue to pray, I'll be reading some questions as prompts. After each, I'll pause, providing space for you to share a word, a phrase, or a silent prayer. For which blessings shall we thank God? For which aspects of church life shall we pray? For which voiceless and powerless persons in our midst and around the world shall we pray? Let us join in an additional moment of silence for those who are mourning and those seeking physical, emotional, or spiritual healing. We lift up these prayers, spoken and unspoken, to you, O God, through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, and we say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Psalm 96, 8 through 9 reads, "Ascribe to Yahweh the glory of his name. Bring an offering and enter his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth." Our tithes and offerings are a symbol of our desire to devote our whole selves to God's service. Tremble. Let us sacrifice all we have to God. Tremble. Yes, tremble. Give up everything that you might live. Tremble. Follow the cruciform Christ. Tremble. Follow Jesus, who both gives us life, yet demands that we lose it. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we give our best, lest in gaining the world we lose life itself. As a covenant people, we seek to witness to your will and way. Help us to know more clearly what you would have us do with the wealth entrusted to our care. As we contribute to the needs of your people, we present ourselves as living sacrifices. Through Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please join me in singing the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Hello again, church. If you have a Bible with you, and I hope you do, please turn in it with me to Jonah 3. Today, I'll be reading from the New International Reader's Version. It can be useful to read from multiple translations, so don't fret if what you're using at home is different. If it helps you to follow along, though, you can easily find the NIRV on your computer or smartphone via Bible Gateway, YouVersion, or a similar app. Let's engage the scriptures today and hopefully throughout the week. Let's take the scriptures seriously as its words encourage and damn us. May we be truly willing to have the light of Christ, which is revealed in the scriptures and in our innermost being, cast our wickedness in revelatory brightness. May we be convicted. May we change. Before we read today's text, will you pray with me? Thank you for communing with us, Abba. Speak to us afresh this morning. Bring life. Reveal yourself. Help us to make room for you here. Help us to get out of the way. Burst through. Hide me and whoever else has already or will be leading in your service today behind the cross of Christ. And it's in whose name we pray. And the people did say, Amen. Hear now the word of the Lord. A message from the Lord came to Jonah a second time. The Lord said, Go to the great city of Nineveh, announce to its people the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the Lord. He went to Nineveh. It was a very large city. In fact, it took about 3 days to go through. Jonah began by going one whole day into the city. As he went, he announced, In 40 days, Nineveh will be destroyed. The people of Nineveh believed God's warning, so they decided not to eat any food for a while, and all of them put on the rough clothing people wear when they're sad. It's what everyone did, from the least important of them to the most important. Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh. He got up from his throne. He took off his royal robes. He also dressed himself in the clothing of sadness. and then he sat down in the dust. Here is the message he sent out to the people of Nineveh. I and my nobles give this order. Don't let people or animals taste anything. That includes your herds and flocks. People and animals must not eat or drink anything. Let people and animals alike be covered with the clothing of sadness. All of you must call out to God with all your hearts. Stop doing what is evil. Don't harm others. Who knows? God might take pity on us. He might not be angry with us anymore. Then we won't die. God saw what they did. He saw that they had stopped doing what was evil. So he took pity on them. He didn't destroy them, as he said he would. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Jonah finally appears to be getting his stuff together. If chapter 1 saw Jonah running away from God, and chapter 2 saw Jonah at least on the surface running back toward God, this third chapter sees Jonah finally running alongside God. He is finally obeying. Jonah is finally working next to God, working with him to achieve his righteous goals in the world. Sure. Took Jonah 3 chapters into a 4-chapter book in order to get on the right path. And we'll see next week that he still doesn't completely get it. But he is, at least, making progress this week. I think it's important to recognize progress. We all fall short. We all have room for improvement. But doesn't it feel good to have someone recognize your effort? Doesn't it feel good to have your progress positively noticed? Well, goodness, yes. So, even though it took basically being hit upside the head with a 2x4 in order for him to listen, Jonah finally goes to Nineveh. Let us take note. Okay. That moment of silence honoring Jonah's seeming repentance might have been a bit in jest, but you know what I mean. Hopefully, you remember how we explored Jonah's prayer from chapter 2, in depth, and discovered some less than flattering problems with it. Jonah doesn't confess or acknowledge his wrongdoings. Even in the midst of the dire consequences of his actions, he is unwilling to go there with God. Where he does go, however, is the making of a new plan. In chapter 1, God commands Jonah to go to Nineveh and preach a message of destruction. In chapter 2, when faced with his own personal destruction, Jonah cries out to God. But in his prayer, he doesn't actually say, if saved, that he will follow through with the task God gave him. Instead, Jonah says he will provide offerings to God. He will provide some manner of outward worship while not necessarily following God's commands. Well, chapter 3 starts off with God reorienting Jonah back to his command from chapter 1. In fact, the wording is near identical. Regardless, Jonah's plan, even if we argue it well-meaning, is trumped by God's plan. Even with our best intentions in mind, which honestly can't be said all of the time, God's plans are superior to ours. They take priority, and God rightly reminds Jonah of that in this chapter's opening verse. This is very important for us to recognize and to translate into our own lives. I mean, how often are we sick of the direction our life is going? So we pray. We cry out to God for help, for guidance, for a new direction, but often we've made the mess we're in. Though God is eager to help, he requires our obedience. Often, had we been obedient in the first place, our lives would have already been on track. We want supernatural solutions to our problems. We want to pray and see God just work miracles in our lives. That'd certainly be easy, right? Sure. Not every time we have issues in life are they issues of our own making. We live in a world with other people. Interpersonally, others impact us, often in negative ways. We live in a world with systems. And on broader scales, these systems frequently weigh us down or even oppress us. But fairly regularly, our mess is our fault. We're out of shape, and rather than commit to lifestyle changes that include altering eating habits and starting to exercise, we just ask God to supernaturally intervene. God has already largely taught us how to be healthy. We know what to do. We're unhappy in our marriages or other types of relationships. Rather than commit to introspection and likewise further behavioral change, we look to God to fix it. But God has already shown us how to live lives of character that will bless those we're in relationships with. Again, we already know what to do. We're worried about churches in decline all around us. We're especially frightened by our own. Rather than deal with tough questions that will bring to light our failures as disciples, we get our feelings hurt and say, well, we just need to keep praying. All this, even though God has already revealed his expectations of us in the scriptures. He continues to reveal himself and his will in our innermost spirit if we only turn from ourselves enough to hear him. We already have the answers. The truth is, we just don't like them. They make us uncomfortable. They take a lot of hard work. They're counterintuitive. They're risky. Like Jonah, we have heard God's commands and we have run from it. Straight in the other direction. Like Jonah, we can pray. We can make outward, if shallow and pretentious, service to God. We can come up with our own plans that suit us better, but just like he did with Jonah, God reorients us to his initial command. We must listen. We must listen. So Jonah finally obeys. Jonah finally goes to Nineveh. He finally goes and tells. The modern implications of this are important to note as well. While God might not be calling us to go and tell of literal destruction to a neighboring nation, he does certainly call us to go and tell. We're to tell of the overturning of corrupt society. We're to tell of hope in the midst of a broken and hurting world. We're to tell individuals of the good news of reconciliation with God and each other and of victory over the devil, sin, and death. One of my favorite Christmas hymns is Go Tell It on the Mountain. That's the crux of the whole New Testament, right? The woman at the well is so shaken by her encounter with Jesus that she converts her whole town. The entire book of Acts is full of story after story of a church living out the Great Commission. Too often, we have replaced the call to go and tell for a flaccid response of come and see. We expect other people to just show up, rather than do the work of inviting them. More scandalous still, the biblical example wouldn't even be to invite folks to church, but rather to take the church to people. But we might not be ready to hear that yet. Okay, back to Jonah. He gives his message. Or rather, he gives God's message to the people of Nineveh. And what happens? They immediately repent. Wholesale, from top down, they get it. They hear God's commands and are changed. We see this with the pagan sailors in chapter 1 who act upon God's commands. We see this with the anthropomorphized fish in chapter 2 who acted upon God's commands. We now see a national response to God's commands by Nineveh. God speaks, they act, lest there be any doubt how thorough the change was, the scriptures tell us that everyone from the most important to the least was in on it, from the king to the beasts of the field. The language here is definitely peculiar. It continues this theme of the fantastical we see throughout the text. Cattle and other animals fasting and wearing sackcloths? I mean, how bizarre! We're meant to understand how all-encompassing repentance is. How deeply we'll need to change to honor God. How profoundly! Not only must we give up everything that separates us from God, but so too must all those complicit in sin. So too should everyone in our sphere of influence, even down to the ox and donkey. Having spent a great deal of time sojourning among Quakers, I'm pretty skeptical of outward shows of faith. Quakers, also called Friends, generally don't fast because they believe it's hypocritical to deny yourself for a time, like during Lent, for instance, only to live in excess the rest of the year. We should live ethics of simplicity and integrity all the time. Quakers historically don't practice water baptism because many are convinced that their water baptism saves them, when really only true baptism of the Spirit, which leads to allegiance to God, can save a person. Likewise, they historically don't practice bread and cup communion because a sacrament can become an easy replacement for true spiritual communion between believers and between the believer and the divine. Brethren, similarly, recognize that communion is never taken outside of a full meal in the scriptures and have patterned our love or agape feasts with this in mind. Rituals can be helpful. If fasting and wearing sad clothing aid your grieving process and assist you on the way towards regeneration, then go for it. Too often, though, our rituals obscure what is most important: true inward change that leads to richer outward action. For the Ninevites, their outward displays were backed up with genuine repentance. They turned. Even Jonah struggled to repent throughout the second chapter. He made a show of his faith, but didn't show spiritual maturity. Again, we see a pagan people respond appropriately to God's revelation, just as we did in chapter 1. The outsider has shown contrition and is our example. It doesn't do any good to pray with words if we aren't willing to pray with our actions. It doesn't do any good to wash another's feet only to gossip about them the next day. It doesn't do any good to participate in these worship services, yet either through ignorance or malice actively work against God's perplexing and dangerous will for the church. We must turn. All of us. Today's passage, Jonah, he finally turns. He stops running from God and obeys. The Ninevites, when made aware of their wrongdoing and the future consequences of it, also turn. Unlike Jonah, the Ninevites are eager to turn. The light has revealed their wickedness. They are embarrassed by it. The rotting stench that all their lives has made them gag, just as the fish gagged Jonah back to dry land. They were blind once they saw, however, their vileness repulsed them. Sin is repulsive. Let us be repulsed. When we waste money, food, or time, let us be repulsed. When we are quick to anger, let us be repulsed. And let me preach that again to myself. When we are quick to anger, let us be repulsed. In the face of bigotry, let us be repulsed. By economic exploitation, let us be repulsed. Let us remember, too, that Jonah and the Ninevites weren't the only ones to turn in today's text. God also turns. Sure, We aren't used to thinking of God in terms of repentance. If God is perfect, what does he have to repent of? But remember, repentance doesn't only mean that we stop doing something bad. Ultimately, it means to turn. It's visceral, and God does turn in this passage. God turns away from his anger. God models for us how we should turn. God is always showing us the way forward. God is our teacher. God walks alongside us. Rather than be the sage on the stage, God chooses to be our guide on the side. He is eager to walk with us. He is eager to walk with us. Will we walk with him? Will we really welcome God into our lives in all his damning complexities? Will we continue to run from or box him in? Or will we take God for who God is? YHWH, or Yad HaWah, is the four-letter word, often called the Tetragrammaton, used as God's proper name in the Hebrew Scriptures. When Moses asks God who he is, God responds with Ehe Asher Ehe, which translates to I am that I am, or I cause into being what I cause to be. When translated into the third person formula, similar to he, Ehe becomes Yahweh. God is that God is. Let that sink in for a moment. God is that God is. Through the Jonah story, we have seen God's power over and over. We have seen his sovereignty. We've also seen his great mercy. While we are all created in God's image, and I believe in taking it a step further by saying there is truly that of God within each of us, God remains remarkably different than us. He stands alone. As I think about this, I'm reminded of another passage, actually a passage from Numbers 23, Numbers being one of the five books of Moses in the Torah. Again, this is Numbers 23, when another servant of God, Balaam, is given the call to go and tell. As we near the end of our sermon, I want to share this other passage with you. I hope it brings you clarity. I hope you're in awe at the marvel that is our God. The word of the Lord. Rise up and listen. Hear me. God isn't a mere human. He can't lie. He isn't a human being. He doesn't flippantly change his mind as mortals do. He speaks and then he acts. He makes a promise and then he keeps it. He has commanded me to bless Israel. He has given them his blessing, and I can't change it. Didn't I warn you that I must do everything the Lord says? May God add his blessing to this reading of his word. What a warning. What a warning, and what that we might all do what God says. As we continue to work through Jonah, let us be reminded of other biblical characters who show us how to listen, how to obey, and likewise, how to go and tell. More so, may we look to God, who is our ultimate example. Let us be like Balaam. Let us be like the pagan sailors, like the fish. Let us heed God's word. Let us follow God's lead. Now, might we transition to a time of reflection, discussion, and, most importantly, application. After pausing this video, you're asked to ponder the following prompts with an accountability partner. 1. Name a time an outward ritual aided in your inner transformation. why and how might the outward ritual have helped you? 2. Conversely, how might you fool yourself into thinking you're in right relationship with God because of your participation in the trappings of faith? And 3, what short-term, and this is important, short-term, in the near future, the immediate, action can you take to follow through with God's call to go and tell? Remember, a time of prayer, singing, and sending will be waiting for you after you're done working through these questions. I look forward to seeing you on the other side. Okay, really do this. Pause. Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, it seems like I smile and I'm laughing a lot when I come to you, but how can I not? This story in Jonah is peculiar. It's fantastical. It's funny. It's absurd. It's audacious. And so too is the entirety of the scriptures, is the entirety of the gospel, of your being, of your interactions with us. It is wild that we assert you listen to us when we're talking to you. Who are we that you would do that? God, I am in awe of who you are. I marvel at you, God. I don't get it. I'll be frank. I don't get why or how you love us, but how you love us. Oh, how you love us. Help us not to squander that love. Help us to listen. Help us to obey. Help us to turn. Help us to turn away from ourself and our sin. May we die to ourself and our sin, that we might be aligned with you, that our life might be in you, that we might... that we might act as if what we say we believe, we actually believe. That we might act that you really are a God who created us, who sustains us. That you really rose from the dead. That you're really coming back. That any of this matters. God, I confess. God, we confess. We fall short far too often. We act in our homes, in our church, in our nation. This isn't real. Convict us, purge us. That our coming benediction is not just a catchphrase that makes a good mission statement. But may we actually love you. May we actually love neighbors. And may we actually make disciples. Help us to go and tell it on the mountain. Christ was born, that he died, and that he rose again. That he sits at your right hand, Father. And that though he will come again to judge, he does indeed love us and is eager to forgive. In his name we pray. Powerful, strong, mighty, loving, tender name of Jesus. Amen. How he loves. Isn't God good? I mean, really. Isn't God good? Let's sing.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Stony the road we tried, bitter the chasing ride, felt in the days when hope unborn had died. Yet with a steady beat, have not our weary feet come to the place for which our people sigh. Tears have been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughter. Out from the gloomy past, till now we stand at last, where the bright gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our weary ears, God of our silent tears, Thou who has brought us thus far on the way, Thou who has by Thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path we pray. Lest our feet stray from the places our God where we may be. Lest our hearts drunk with the wine of the world we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Beset with these words from Psalm 20, verse 7, and please join me. Some trust in chariots, some trust in horses, but we trust in the Lord our God. Go. Love God, love neighbors, make disciples. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Amen.